terms of the physical development, the stuff I do with them, trying to make them move better and be better athletes, is geared around this. You know, they have to have the ability to manage their body weight competently. Okay, and how do we do that? With whole body, ground-based, multi-joint movements, and they've got to control it and they've got to coordinate it. Okay, so this doesn't mean we go into the gym and we sit on the bench press machine and do this. You know, they're on their feet, they're having to move through a large range of motion in a similar fashion to what they will do when they're playing table tennis. Okay, this is where we try to get the carryover. So to keep it simple, these are kind of what I focus on. They must be able to squat well, in a good position, to lunge, to hinge, to be able to push and pull, to brace, and then produce force by jumping up and reduce force by landing. Now, by having an equal distribution of this, we don't want athletes that do lots of push-ups end up like this, okay? So we try to balance everything out, and again, if we can put them in a strong position where they can squat and hinge, and they've got the strength in the upper body to both push and pull, hopefully they'll be able to hold positions during training longer so that we can get better quality training in, okay? Now again, the main takeaways for you guys here is they've got to be competent, it's got to be controlled and coordinated. Just quickly, how many of you actually have access to an NSCA coach, a fitness coach? Okay, we've got one hand. And how many of you take it upon yourself to do it? Okay, so this is what I'm trying to gear it towards is, okay, not everyone will have the luxury of having an NSCA coach to do this. So you can take these movements here and incorporate them into a warm-up if you need to. And then the easiest way to do that and to make sure that they are competent, controlled, and coordinated is to look at it, okay? The easiest way I can say to you, if it looks good, it probably is good, okay? So just these two images here, the one on the left or the one on the right, which one do you think is, you know, ideal? Which one, as an S&C coach, would I be happy with? A or B? Anyone think A is the best one?
B.
B?
Yeah, B.
Okay. A? Yeah. So A. So the main thing we're looking for here is, you know, they have the control to be in this position. It's not too clear in this picture, but on B, we can see his knees coming into that weaker position, okay? So this is what I say, when if it looks good, it probably is good. These two are a bit more obvious. A or B, which one do you think's the best? A? Yeah. So everyone's happy that that doesn't look quite right? So you kind of pull it up. And then A and B, you know, hopefully, that screams out to you that's not right. It's the same as when you watch table tennis and you see a bad shot, you can see that's not quite right. So hopefully this will give you some guidelines. And it's the same for other movements, okay? So hinging through the back, probably not ideal. Squatting through here, probably not ideal. And doing a push-up, okay? So everyone's kind of got a rough idea, hopefully, what these movements should look like. And you can tell me that these aren't the ones you want, okay? So if you do incorporate this with your athletes, please just bear this in mind and use this as a rule of thumb. Once they can do this and it looks good, you can progress them through. But if they haven't mastered it, you know, take your time, let them develop. And the reason I say that is, just quick show of hands, who'd like to drive this car if I gave you the keys today? I'd take it, yeah. Who'd drive it if it had no brakes? Yeah. Not quite as tempting, is it? So the same comes from the physical side. You know, we want these athletes to perform on a daily basis, but potentially they don't have the ability to brake or to control their movement. So for us, it's trying to develop the coordination, the control, so that they can competently perform these tasks whilst being able to train and compete. For you guys, how do you take it away and how do you use it? That is a good question. What I would suggest and what we try and do here is incorporate it into the warm-up for at least 10 to 15 minutes. If we're training for 2 hours, you know, I try and get about 10 to 15 minutes with these guys. Fortunately, the coaches here support that and give me access to the athletes, you know, pretty much all the time. And I try and do it in a dual role. So I'm getting them warm and ready for the session so they can go to the coaches and train. But equally, I'm coaching them on a daily basis, trying to make them better slowly. I think you all agree, you know, 10 to 15 minutes every day will quickly add up over the weeks and the months. But some things to consider here. When programming, depending on the groups you're working with, you might have a mix of ages, you might have males and females. So there's a few things to bear in mind, okay? So the chronological age, how old are they? So these could both be 14-year-olds on the right. but one of them has gone through peak height velocity and grown, and he's actually about the size of a 16-year-old. This kid here is 14, but he hasn't yet developed and grown, so he could be 12. But they still fall under the age, the same age. So it's worth considering, you know, athletes grow at a different rate, so it doesn't mean that we give them the same program all the time. If one athlete's performing very well and can deal with the exercises, there's no problem pushing them on. Equally, if one athlete's taking a little bit longer to develop, you can take your time and just rein it back a little bit. The same goes for training age, you know. You might have kids that come into your program from day one, and you might have them that join later who've possibly not had the exposure to training. So what you'll tend to find is athletes with a greater training history that have trained longer, be it table tennis or physically, should be more competent than those that haven't. So again, bearing in mind, you know, this kid here could be 16 in a 14 group, but he's never trained in the gym, so you might have to make it very basic and simple for him in terms of what you do. Emotional maturity. Again, from a physical side, once they start getting into the gym and doing exercises like that, there is a greater risk for them to get injured. So we have to make sure that they have the emotional maturity to listen to instruction, to focus for a period of time to do the exercise. Yeah, sometimes that's not going to be the luxury, so you might have to keep it short and just work on one or two movements a day, and then that's you done. And then you'll do the same thing the next day with a different movement. And again, preaching to the choir as coaches, you'll know you've got good athletes and bad athletes and how they work, but it's the same from the physical side. The same body size is, I've showed you push-ups and squats and everything, but if we're giving both of these athletes the same exercises, you know, I'm pretty sure he weighs a bit more than the other guy. Okay, so for him doing a push-up or a squat might be a bit harder, so that you might not always give them, you know, 10 reps. This big guy might need 5, and that's him done. Okay, so it's just knowing your athletes and knowing their limitations. Same goes for fitness levels. You've got the fitter athletes and the not so fit. If you all give them the same stimulus, some of it's too high for some of it's too low, everyone ends up about average. Okay. Again, as coaches, you should know your athletes and you can progress it that way as well. And then coming back to technical competency, if they look good and they move well, progress them, you don't have to hold them back. Equally, if it doesn't look good, just take your time, okay? They will catch up. The technical and tactical training and how that can influence the physical development here. So what we've got here, it doesn't show up very clearly, but that's a heart rate belt that all our athletes will wear during training. And then that's the monitoring system that we'll see, we can record live what they do. And all this tells us and shows us is how hard they're working, okay? As coaches, you can probably see they're working hard when they're sweating and they're sort of hunched over the table drinking water. Equally, if they're just serving, you know, you can probably guarantee it's an easier session. But all this shows is that our athletes have trained for 2 hours, they've burned nearly 900 calories, and this shows you how hard they've worked at a peak and during the duration of the session. So we fitness test our boys sort of every 3 to 4 months, and we find out how high their maximum heart rate is, and then we can quantify training based off that. So instead of saying it was a hard session or an easy session, we can look at this and say anything in the red is between 90 to 100% of their maximum heart rate. That's a tough session. The same goes for yellow, 80 to 90, that's tough. Somewhere in between green, that's medium, and then 60 and below, that's probably service, short sessions, quite easy. And this will give you a breakdown of what that session consisted of. So we can see here that they spent nearly 10 minutes in their top zone, so that's pretty tough in a 2 hour session. They then spent a further 40 minutes in zone 4. So this could be, you know, they've had sparring partners, they've had many balls, they've potentially done some matches. So we know that that is a hard session for the boys. If we compare that to matches, these are three of our younger athletes, and they all play each other, okay? So you can see there's games going on in this column and games going on in this column here. So what happened in the first game is these are the two stronger athletes in terms of technical ability, and athlete C here is having to work really hard in that red zone, whereas athlete B, not so much, okay? I'd say these two boys are fairly similar in terms of their playing ability, but actually watching this live, this athlete here had to move around a lot and was actually losing a lot of points here. He ended up winning, you can see as he got into his rhythm, he's not working as hard. you compare this to the next game, where athlete C plays athlete A, this is a lower quality of table tennis player that's playing, and we can see that there's a massive gap compared to the first game in terms of how hard they're having to work. So again, not everyone's going to have access to this, but this is a luxury we have, and we can compare, you know, how hard they work in matches, and we compare that to the level of athlete they're playing against. Now, what's really important is looking at what does training and what does a match give you, okay? So during training, you know, for this 2 hour session, we might not have hit anything in the red zone, okay? But when we play a match, we can spend, you know, close to 10 minutes pretty much in that red zone. So for us, it's having the ability to say that sometimes in training, we might not hit the red zone or prepare them for the hardest level of intensity that a match might throw up against them. So there's one way that we'll try and do it another way to address this. Now again, these are the same three athletes, and this is a 10-minute warm-up. You know, without saying too much more, does anyone want to take a guess at what this session could have been? I'm sorry it's a bit vague, but I just want to see if anyone's got any ideas.
What's the total duration of the session?
So this is just a 10-minute warm-up. Okay?
Just warm-up.
This is just a warm-up, okay? But as you can see in this warm-up, you know, this athlete is hitting quite high in intensity.
Sprinting?
Close. This was actually a foot match that the boys did prior to their table tennis session. And again, they don't always play football, but sometimes it's nice to mix it up. And so as you can see here, is that as time goes on, this athlete is spending more and more time in the red zone and in the yellow zone here. And the athlete that this is on is currently this kid just coming in here, okay? He loves football. So we'll see. If he stood up, just him running around, enjoying himself, but working hard as well. And again, one of the issues we try and address is what's limiting their potential as a table tennis player. If some of these athletes need more fitness, I can run them, I can stick them on the bike, they'll get fitter. Again, we can do this, they can enjoy themselves. This was the last day of the training week for them, so they tend to come in quite tired and quite lethargic, so sometimes it's nice to mix things up for them, get them engaged in a sport they don't always get to play. So yeah, this was a 10-minute football match for them that addresses the fitness point of view. So I'm conscious of time, I don't want to keep you guys too much longer. So other than that, thank you very much.
TRX system for this stage, you recommend it?
Sorry, which system?
TRX.
Yes. But yeah, something where they have to control their whole body weight, I think TRX works quite nicely. So where it fits into, as you can see here, so TRX would kind of fall into this category here, where they can pull their own body weight. Again, they can do squats, they can hold on, it gives them a nice bit of support. They can do single leg squats controlling. Yeah, TRX is a great sort of tool to use. If you don't have access to any other facilities, you can hang out over the door. And again, as long as they're controlling the movement, it's coordinated, and it looks good, it's perfect. You know?